All right, and we should be full screen.
Okay.
Go for it.
What you thinking? Wow. One, two, three, four, five, divided by six. What's the answer? I have no clue. But this thing can figure it out in a fraction of a second. Should that bother me? Should I be worried? No. We're all comfortable with the idea that computers can do logical functions much faster than we can. But I still feel special because I can be creative. I can make art. Well, I was telling this to a friend, Mike Cook, who works in artificial intelligence. And he told me that AI is actually making huge inroads into the art world, and that very soon it's really going to explode. So this led me to a question. Could an AI make a better, more aesthetically pleasing picture than I can? So here it is, Thursday, June 3rd, 2021. I challenge you, artificial intelligence, to an art off. May the better intelligence win.
Okay, hey.
Hey, Greg.
Mike, howdy.
Good to see you.
Good to see you. I brought my
fantastic
creativity kit here. Some colored pencils.
That takes
this is
me back.
John Henry versus the machine. I'm convinced that creativity is kind of the realm of organic minds, but I'm beginning to question that. And I thought, okay, what's one thing that we usually think of as creative would be something like drawing. So I've got my stuff, so we're gonna get you involved as well, right?
Yeah, okay. I'm up for it.
So
fantastic.
You can use this stuff here.
Excellent. Okay.
We won't fight over the colors like my kids do. So how are we actually gonna challenge the computer here?
So I'm going to be typing in this prompt, and I'm actually just going to say a peaceful landscape in a hand-drawn style. And that request is being whisked away to my colleague's AI, and it's working on it in the background right now.
Okay.
So we better get going.
All right. That's fascinating. Okay. I'm going to, the times that have always felt the most peaceful for me would be snorkeling out in La Jolla, California, where I would just let myself sink below the water, right down along the bottom, and just kind of rest on the bottom, or just go down deep, deep, deep in the water, and just sort of watch the fish move around. So that's what I'm going to try to evoke here.
That sounds
and
pretty
you
spectacular.
You are going to do...
So near where I grew up, I grew up on the south coast of England, and there's a sort of small seaside town called Swanage. It has this very beautiful old pier, which I love walking out onto, and there's a lot of special memories out on that pier, so I'm going to try and do my very best to sort of remember what that pier looks like.
Okay, so I'll draw a sandy bottom with ridges that come from the waves, and I will draw some coral.
As I'm finding my inner Bob Ross and working out where to put my happy little kelp fronds, Mike points out the nuances of creativity and AI.
When we think about AI, we think about things like self-driving cars and medical scanning and things like that. And those are things where there are very clear right and wrong answers. But
okay.
When it comes to creativity, it's a lot more about what we think about creativity, about our opinion as a society, as a community. Creativity is what Simon Colton calls an essentially contested concept. And what he means by that is that actually the fact that we argue about what creativity is part of what its function is in society, as in it's designed for us to argue about and disagree
okay.
about. So in many ways, it's a very funny field to work in because we're building these systems and AI at the end of the day have to be precise at some time. You know, they have to be lines of code in a computer. But when we present them to people, they always have gut reactions. And that colors your response to everything we make. In the art world, the visual art world, people tend to be biased against computers producing art. But what I found in my primary area, in video game design, is that a lot of video game developers are extremely excited about the idea of AI designing games.
Right.
They love it. They're actually biased in the other direction. And one of the reasons about that is that we're interested in things like how it produces it, why it produces it. And naturally, you know, the public wants to ask these questions. And what we found is that when we're honest about the AI and when we actually tell people, yes, an AI made this and they did it in this way, people respond to this much better. They feel a sense of connection and investment. And I actually think our collaborator is finished with their entry. Our AI is done. So if you want to, we can...
This is as done as I'm going to get it. I don't think it's getting any better.
I'm honestly feeling the same way about mine.
Better. We're starting at a pretty low point to begin with.
So we can throw this up on the big screen and have a look at it and compare it to our work.
Let's do it.
Okay, so I have no idea what to expect here. Has the AI created an artistic mess, or has it produced a masterpiece?
All right, and we should be full screen.
Okay.
Go for it.
Wow.
I have to say, I'm really impressed by this because it's very unpredictable. You don't always get, you know, great results out, but I think this is exactly what I was hoping to get for you today. So I'm especially glad. What do you think?
That's awesome. I mean, it's really impressive. I could never do anything that good, that's for sure. And I certainly haven't on mine. I mean, so, you know, obviously it's got many of the tropes, the cliches that we think of when we do a peaceful landscape, a solitary individual in water or a path. And you've got these trees that even look like they're blowing, maybe in the wind and the sky.
They do, you're right, actually, yeah.
Very, very sort of solitude, quietude, peaceful place in nature. You know, you don't see any top predators running around except for man, if that is a man, or if it's a robot. I don't know what it's decided to put in there. So this certainly looks, you know, extremely creative from the point of view of the mini details, and yet the tropes seem almost programmed, seem almost guessable, right? So how has it decided what to leave in and what to leave out and how to make that nuance?
The amazing thing about this is that this system was never kind of explicitly told what a tree is or what it means to be hand-drawn. What it did was it was shown a lot of images and a lot of text and often the relationship between them. And from this, it's learned to associate certain groups of pixels or certain shapes over an image with certain textual kind of combinations.
So it's not drawing out a database of trees. It knows it should put a tree there, and therefore it makes... And is that sort of why we don't know whether this is a river or a path? It's not said put a river, it said put a group of pixels that have contrast or not at the edges?
It's even vaguer than that. So imagine that you're standing on a stage with an easel in front of you, and you've got a big audience, and you've got this sort of clapometer to see how much they're enjoying it, right? And as you start to paint, you know, some of them start clapping and some of them don't. This AI system, this neural network, has a lot of different ways of sort of understanding, like, what this image looks like. And it's possible to watch these images form. And at the beginning, it looks like nonsense. It looks like garbage. And then over time, you see shapes begin to emerge. And what's happening is, as these shapes are emerging, different parts of the neural network are firing and saying, okay, this is good, this is better, this is what I wanted. But of course, sometimes that's a tug of war, because by increasing the peacefulness of it, you might be decreasing the landscapiness of it. Yes. And so the system's trying to find a compromise, and eventually it will stop. And here it stops, and you can see, you're not sure if this is a path or a stream, but crucially, the AI probably has a sense that it doesn't matter, because both paths and streams can be in peaceful landscapes. And so this compromise is actually fine. And that gives these AI-generated artworks a sort of, for me at least, it gives them a slightly haunting quality.
Well, I'm starting to definitely feel less special, because when I think about the process that I go through when I'm drawing, I had my own internal clapometer. I realize as you're doing, I'm sort of drawing, how does a reef look? I've not drawn enough of them. I'll get a little gray and I'll kind of do it like this. And that kind of looks good. Oh, what if I darken this up? Oh, that looks even better. And it really was a dynamic process. Okay, so I'm going to throw in the towel and say that I have been bested. Because there's my picture, and I have to say, from a technical point of view, this is just prettier, I guess.
At first glance, it looked like the AI had outdone us at art. But then Mike revealed that it was missing a key ingredient.
Well, let me ask you a question. Which one do you prefer, the AI's or mine?
What are we trying to achieve? What simply prefer?
If you were going to hang one on the wall...
it wouldn't be mine. How about that? I'll put yours second, but I'm going to choose the AI first.
But I can tell you about this, because this pier here, I used to come here with my family a lot. Mm-hmm. And actually, when my dad passed away, we scattered his ashes at the end of this pier.
Oh, wow.
And so this is a very special place for me. And creativity isn't just about Rembrandts and Van Goghs and the thing that we see in galleries. It's the jokes that we make in our WhatsApp groups and the TikToks that we send each other. And a lot of creativity is about telling each other stories and sharing with one another. And that's actually more than 50% of our field, computational creativity. Getting computers to do beautiful things is part of it. But the reason why, you know, you came in here a little bit worried that, you know, the AI might be able to outsmart you. And the thing is that creativity will always be a way for humans to connect to one another. And so today I feel like we've shared a lot just by drawing these little sketches.
Yeah, yeah.
They're not good sketches. My sketch is terrible, but
I can tell you a little story. But I've learned about you from that.
And often that's the case, right?
Yeah.
If you hang a painting on your wall and then you have some friends over and you want to tell them the story of how you went, you know, snorkeling in California and it reminds you of that happy place, I think those human stories will be very important, very special to people.
All right, well, I've been having trouble coming up with a logo for the channel, so let's see what we can do and see if the computer can beat us. Go.
So I had a question. Can an AI make a more aesthetically pleasing picture than I can? And the answer was humblingly, yes, very much so. However, Mike Cook has challenged my definition of art and told me that creativity is more than just about what you make, but how you make it, the emotions that you put into it, and the stories that it can help to tell. And in this sense, we have either a perceived or a real relationship between the viewer and the artist. So, my picture may be rubbish, but at least it's my rubbish. And that has earned it an exalted place on my refrigerator. Until next time, remember that between the question and the answer are all of the really tasty bits.
Well, you're a very cold parent by the sound of it.
Oh, why, thank you. I think my kids might say otherwise, but hope if only this were being recorded for posterity.
And they would try to get around the discriminator. Touchdown! Hey! Can we have Mike explain this, please?
The green tastes leafy. Does this count as one of my five a day?
Thanks for watching. Like and subscribe.